As a daily watcher of Sailor Moon in my youth and a lover of RPGs, you can imagine my dashed hopes when I started looking into the video game side of the series. I learned that most installments were brawlers or one-on-one fighting games, and as someone who has to look down at the controller during the thief battles in Yoshi's Island just to remember which buttons are which, I had a snowball's chance in hell of being able to pull off anything competently in those kinds of games. I eventually found out about Pretty Soldier Sailor Moon and Other Story for the Super Famicom. It's a lone turn-based RPG experience that had all of my favorite Sailor Scouts on the box along with a few other people I didn't recognize. I was totally pumped to dive into a solid nostalgia trip and get immersed in that world again. At least, that's what I'd been hoping for. The game follows a very complex story about resisting the efforts of a group of young women called the Oppositio Senshi. They're working under a larger negative force whose plan is to alter the destinies of people of their world by manipulating events in the past through time travel. The primary motivators are gaining more power for themselves by diverting it away from the Sailor Scouts and their allies, but to also change the fates that they've personally been dealt for the better. The plot winds in all sorts of directions, backwards and forwards through time, but before you sigh about this being yet another time travel RPG, it provides a neat mechanism to revisit many characters that have come and gone in the show's canon. Fans of the series will be really glad to see some familiar evil faces on this journey in addition to having all of the Sailor Scouts accounted for. If you're like me and you only watched the North American dub from the 90s, you'll probably be at a bit of a loss on the stories of the four Outer Scouts, since they only appeared in the series much later than what aired on Canadian television back then. A frustration that I have with this game in general is just how little exposition it dishes out about these characters, and makes a huge assumption that anyone playing is very familiar with all of the source material. I'll dive into more of that later on, but as a warning, you can expect to play some catch-up if you don't know who some of the main cast and supporting characters are. The visuals immediately stood out to me. The character sprites are stunning and rival the beauty of the work of games like Chrono Trigger, Secret of Mana, or the SNES Final Fantasy games. Each girl has lots of unique animations, like their victory poses at the end of battles or when they're struck by an enemy. There are loads of little touches in their appearances, like differences in their clothing that reflect how they looked in the show. All of the locations you visit are eye-catching as well, with lots of intricacies incorporated into their designs. The mucky look of early SNES games is completely absent here, with every backdrop being bright and elaborately decorated. I really loved the era-specific objects like rotary phones, and especially how everybody seemed to have bought the same giant TV set. You can easily tell a lot of care went into planning every inch of these environments, but my one gripe was that there wasn't a lot to do in many of them. There were tons of houses and buildings to enter in every segment of the game, but barely anything could be interacted with. Many places were completely devoid of people to talk to and only existed to take up your time while exploring. Despite furiously tapping on doors, cabinets, shelves, beds, and tables, I was rarely rewarded for my efforts. That's not to say that there's nothing to find this way, but there's just not a lot of it. The story conversations and cutscenes feature not only the facial avatars of the starring heroines, but also countless other characters in this absolutely packed cast. I thought that this was really impressive compared to the vague text boxes that float over people's heads in other games, and this felt very ahead of its time. I will say that it was a bit strange seeing one or two static, usually smiling images of the main characters, no matter if good or bad things were happening in a cutscene. Artemis was particularly funny to me, since he often said some very important, dire things that were accompanied by his expectant, goofy, grinning face. It was like he just couldn't read the room sometimes, and that tickled me. The turn-based combat occupies about 80% of your time in this quest, so it's a good thing that the battle visuals were also above average. I like that the backdrops match the location that you were currently exploring, and that variety was welcome versus staring at something more generic for hours on end. You'll probably also recognize many of the monsters from the animated series and the movies if you're familiar with those stories, and their likenesses were translated well into sprite form. As someone who plays a lot of RPGs where you beat up animals, fish, and insects for cash, it was a breath of fresh air seeing bad guys from the show rather than your typical RPG monsters roaming fields and forests. Foes could deal out physical and special attacks that would impart status effects on your party members, and the latter here were absolutely brutal in the beginning of the game. Numbness, which is essentially like poison, came up within the first few hours and it took off enormous chunks of health compared to what my total HP even was in that point of the game. I never thought I'd say this, but it bothered me that the enemies and bosses didn't work up to progressively more awful attacks as the game went on. Numbness took off the same amount of health per turn at the beginning as it did near the end, and other than occasionally getting turned to stone in the back half, most random encounters and boss fights used the same small handful of status effects that just go away after the battle ends. And if it was a long fight, any status ailment could be cured with one widely available and very cheap item called Bath Medic. The effects were even rarely an inconvenience, and the only thing that made me sweat in tougher boss fights were if the enchantment or selfishness statuses affected my big hitter, since it causes you to lose control of their actions. I'm not saying that combat didn't come with its trials, but anything that was thrown my way felt almost too easy sometimes, and I prefer a game where there's a bit more risk involved every time you wander out of town, never knowing where your next game over is going to come from. This was the polar opposite of that experience. Because another story is structured to guide you from plot point with specific characters in your active group, there wasn't a lot of room to wander around aimlessly with your party members intact and become overleveled. This created a situation where lots of experience grinding was essential every time the game switched gears. I felt this the most in the solo missions for the Sailor Scouts in Chapter 2, especially with Sailor Jupiter, who was getting flattened if there was even more than one monster to face off with. After a few fights, things always got easy again. I personally would have enjoyed a bit more strategy rather than just brute forcing my way through these sections, but this also means that another story is approachable for people that are new to the genre or want a more relaxed experience than something like the Seventh Saga. Since I didn't have access to a readable manual, I was initially worried that I'd be at some kind of disadvantage in terms of general information on weapons or items. It was a big relief to see that every single thing that you can purchase or find comes with a description or an explanation of sorts, even if sometimes they make you do a double take. I still don't know what kind of accidents pork chops fix, but that's a bit of lore I'm glad to leave as a question mark in my mind. They even included a tutorial room very early in the game to break down the combat interface. While there's nothing wildly different from many other menu-based RPGs, I thought that that was a nice gesture. Fantastic quality of life additions like menu memory between battles that really streamline the experience are also here. The moves that you choose for each member from the previous encounter are saved so that you're not always fussing with the menus every time. Another excellent feature is that EP, the equivalent to magic points in other games, fully restores after each fight. It's a bit of a trade-off, because while you'll never have more than 12 EP regardless of your level, you're guaranteed to start off each battle full. Lots of EP restoring consumables actually exist to purchase at shops as well, so it's a lot friendlier than other games that make refilling magic points so much more difficult or rare. The special moves that use up these points are pretty awesome too. More often than not, they're more effective than physical attacks, and they're directly based on each character's abilities in the show. Visually, they're cool to look at, but I could have done without the extremely repetitive yelling of the move names from the scouts every single time. I'm a big fan of exciting fights, but considering how frequent random encounters are and how much I relied on these moves to grind up quickly, I found myself missing the peace and quiet of silent spellcasters from Final Fantasy games. The worst vocal abominations came from Chibi Moon or Rini. How they managed to make her shrill little voice crack whenever she throws her barrette around is beyond me, but I just had her defend most of the time, so I didn't have to hear it anymore. Some special attacks are extremely overpowered, like Sailor Saturn's. Since I wasn't familiar with what happens with her story in the anime, I'd only heard whisperings of how she was a force to be reckoned with. When she joined my party, once she had a few of her special items equipped, she was easily hitting at least 10 times harder than the rest of my crew for a large part of the game. It honestly felt like cheating, but it was also a relief to not have to worry about marching into new territory for a while. Another jaw-dropper was Sailor Pluto's Time Stop that works like a charm almost every battle. It stops enemies for 3 turns, and this even works on bosses, even the final boss. Between Sailor Saturn and Sailor Pluto, this game starts to feel like skipping happily through a field of flowers rather than fighting the supreme evils that are trying to erase you from existence. Apart from these individual moves, additional specials for groups of Sailor Scouts can be set by linking different combinations of them in a separate menu from the rest of the game options. While this is really cool in theory, actually unlocking these was really clunky. You have to manually group up to 3 Sailor Scouts and learn those abilities in the menu before they can be used in battle, and the possible number of combinations is staggering. I'm not sure if the manual would have been helpful here, but there's nothing in-game that indicates who could be linked. Apparently there's a higher likelihood if they were friends in the show, but as I mentioned earlier, I only knew 6 of the 10 girls, so that information wasn't helpful to me. Nowadays, there are comprehensive resources that spell everything out, but it would have been great if options based on who you put in your party just appeared for you to use, or could be learned as you fought with others like they do in Chrono Trigger. I had no way of knowing if these combination attacks would even be any better than anyone's individual moves, and it was way too much work to experiment with meaningfully. I'm sure I missed out on some interesting stuff, but not having these abilities at my disposal didn't affect how I was able to play the game at all. Another thing that bothered me were the party formations. There are four to choose from, and unfortunately, I went through most of the game using one that was not the most advantageous because I didn't know any better. Without a manual for help, I made a few assumptions based on my experience from other RPGs. Some have front row and back row strategies, where you stick your good offense and high defense people up front, and low defense and ranged attack people in the back. That sentiment sort of exists here, but it's a bit more complex than that. Each spot in the various formations have offense and defense multipliers that are nowhere to be found except in guides online. Take my advice and don't even bother playing with anything else but the cluster formation. The middle position apparently adds 4 times the attack to whoever you put there, and it also has the best balance for other positions in the front and back rows. The others are absolute garbage. It was disappointing that something as basic and essential as this was shrouded in mystery. Knowing a little more might have saved me a lot of trouble. There were a couple of spots where the difficulty balancing was all out of whack. The first time I encountered this was in Chapter 2, playing as Sailor Mercury on her solo mission in Rayness Village. I was kicking random encounter enemies' butts, and I thought I was ready to tackle the boss at the end, but when I got there, their defense was too high to do much of anything. None of my physical or special attacks even put a dent in her, and we pretty much poked each other for 30 minutes until the boss ran out of EP and the battle speed finally picked up. Something similar happened later on after a segment of the game that forces you to split up your party. The 5 girls I played through that with were almost 10 levels ahead of the benched crew, since experience isn't gained by inactive party members. The problem stemmed not just from the difficulty of the fight itself, but also the area we were in. We were revisiting a place from earlier on where experience gains from random battles were pitiful, so leveling up would have taken forever. I did have the option to sub in my stronger party members for this fight, but I also didn't want the weaker characters to get even further behind. I easily spent an hour trying to beat this encounter, mostly doing damage control every few rounds and struggling to revive characters that got killed. It was horrible. This was one of the few times I really felt frustrated, but nothing got me down more than the story did. You see, I was banking on a wonderful walk down memory lane while revisiting the world I spent every afternoon after school growing up in. What I ended up with was a perpetual flow of questions because this game covers so much of the Sailor Moon series that I personally have no context for. For an avid fan in tune with all of the show's lore, a game like this is a dream come true, and it must have been a real treat to see so many characters come and go from the various arcs, but for me, I always felt totally lost. The character cameos fizzled one by one, and I heard many names here for the very first time. The narrative doesn't do you any favors to fill in those blanks either, but that's more of a problem with me than it is for the game. I came to this RPG way more uninformed about Sailor Moon than I thought I was, and it made enjoying the story a real struggle. I will say that I did get a few great memory jogs with names and faces from the Queen Beryl arc, but I wish that alone had been good enough to make me love it. Unfortunately, it wasn't. I should also mention that I played the translation patch from 1999. While the localization efforts were decent, I did struggle understanding what a few things in the game were as they came up. Without the help of some of the chatters during my live streams, even more meaning would have been lost on me since certain words and phrases were left untranslated. Some of the writing came across as nonsense, especially toward the end of the game, but it didn't detract too much from the overall experience. There's a new translation patch from 2020 available that's supposed to clarify and improve upon the original, so if you're planning to play another story, maybe consider trying that one out instead. I don't think it would have helped me personally because of the big knowledge gaps I apparently have with the anime, but it might be a better read than this one. Pretty Soldier Sailor Moon: Another Story was an excellent and competent RPG experience in terms of its gameplay mechanics. I would especially recommend it for anyone new to the genre because even at its core, without all of the advanced tech that's hard to sift through, it offers many great quality of life options that would serve newer adventurers well. Taking away the few terrible boss encounters with mountainous difficulty and some localization issues, this game was really approachable, fun, and an absolute beauty to look at for many hours at a time. I truly feel that if I had been more well-versed in the series as a whole, that this might have very easily become a favorite of mine, but instead it's joining some others in a pile of games that didn't quite live up to the hype for me. What this quest did best was perfectly capture the essence of Sailor Moon and all of the things that made the show so appealing to me in my youth. It might not have given me everything that I wanted out of the experience, but superfans of the show will definitely adore this one.